nice things on the set. It's rare that you have that where crew members, a lot of them had the book, mm-hmm. you know, obviously the actors and the director, but rarely, I mean, with an adaptation, Lord of the Rings was a case yeah. where a lot of people had it the whole year, and they'd be excited, oh, we're going to shoot that scene now. Mm-hmm. But in this case, because the adaptation of Cormac McCarthy's book, you know, The Road was so much, in a way, I mean, there was less scope, so it was mm-hmm. easier to do it, but it was very faithful in spirit, and when you read the book, if you mm-hmm. do, you'll see it's pretty much the book, you know, in a good way, not slavishly faithful, right. but it's right there, so then people would know, now today we're going to shoot the scene where the kid makes his transition, how's right. that going to go, and when you can feel that from the crew and from the actors, when everybody's rooting for it to work.
Yeah.
It really helps an actor a lot.
It sounds like John really picked his moments to, you know, pick through the book instead of changing it. It kind of like he took his spots and found a way to make that all fit together.
Yeah, because, I mean, different medium, you know, Cormac McCarthy's one of his strengths, if not his primary strength, is mm-hmm. the power of his descriptions, you know, his prose. Mm-hmm. And it's a visual medium, so those things were accomplished by just seeing the places where you're in and feeling by watching mm-hmm. the relationship, you know, how we got along and didn't get along, how we reacted to each other and to others and to the environment. That's what he described so well, but it's another thing to do it, and that was really fun.
Was it intimidating at all? I mean, when you took this on, did you...
Yeah, yeah. I mean, not so much the... You know, there's going to be somebody that loves the book that's going to find fault with something or other, I'm sure. It's not the same thing. It's a different
right.
It's a different thing. But not so much that. The same pressure I always feel. I don't want to let people down. I mm-hmm. want to do a good job. I want to contribute, not be an impediment to telling the story well. But I was, just as an actor, to be honest with you, I was nervous a little bit. I knew that... I would have to be really focused, really relaxed, and lucky, mm-hmm. you know, because there's a lot of, yes, it's physically difficult, but it's more mm-hmm. of an emotionally difficult journey. It's not just the obvious, which there are several moments where it's emotionally intense, but there's something that my character carries throughout. He's carrying mm-hmm. a certain amount of regret and sadness over having lost the world the way it was, something the mm-hmm. kid doesn't even understand, so I can't really even talk about that with mm-hmm. him. And in fact, I don't want him to worry about that so much. I just want him to survive in this world. And being a kid, he's more present, more in the mm-hmm. moment. The adults tend to be thinking about the future and the past and taking care of things. And they're not always as present. Kids are more present. But he's even more so than a regular
yeah.
kid because he knows no other world other than this ravaged one. And so I knew I was going to be, to do the character right, I was going to have to believably get that across, that I'm carrying that. And I was also nervous about the child, you
yeah.
know, who, how are they going to find a boy that can do this, you know? It's one thing to say, yeah, it's great, we're going to make this movie, and we're going to really go for it, and
mm-hmm.
John, it sounds like your design is really good, you've got the great cinematographer, Javier Aguirre-Sarobe, who... I think Javier did an incredible job. I mean, it's very understated
in a way.
Movie.
I mean, well, considering what you're looking at, it is so
it's
beautiful.
It's terribly beautiful, you
yeah.
know? And a lot of times cinematographers get credit for the ones who get nominated for awards and so
mm-hmm.
forth. Are not always, but usually they're more flashy, you know,
mm-hmm.
and they have more equipment and they have more lights. In this case, he, you know, in agreement with the director, obviously,
mm-hmm.
and the overall design, did a lot with very little
mm-hmm.
intentionally, so he had to keep that low light, he had to keep those grays, you know,
mm-hmm.
that lack of color, you know, that dead look, and but it's somehow it's really beautiful, it's
yeah.
very sad, but it's beautiful. He really helped make the landscape important, you know.
Did the lack of that stuff help you as an actor, not having as much machinery involved? Or does it matter?
You know, that doesn't matter that much if you're in it. If you're there
mm-hmm.
with the other actor, it doesn't it allowed us to travel. We took you know, light and move quickly, and we had limited days because it was winter time,
right.
Limited light and time to shoot it. But it was really my main concern, I think, was, and maybe it was John's, I don't know if he said this or not, but was finding a boy who would be able to play those scenes, which we did.
And not be a child actor. I mean, that was the thing. There are kids who are, you know, precocious.
Yeah.
And he didn't have that.
Well, any kid who's at all talented can, by virtue of being precocious, can just get lucky and do these things. You go, wow, nobody could ever do that. You know, he won't be able to repeat that, but he could do it again and again. Mm-hmm. He thought about the scene that came before. I mean, he was very mature in his approach to it, which really helped him and me and the story.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, speaking about the landscape, as much as the story is, you know, the road is a metaphor, really, for a the journey or the clarification of the relationship between father and a son, an adult and a child, and it's a vehicle, you know, toward coming to an understanding. The characters come to understand, and I think the audience does, what kindness really means, you know. There's, you know, the wild, Where the Wild Things Are, that movie's coming out soon, and Sendak wrote something one time. He said, there has to be more to life, I'm paraphrasing, more to life than having everything. And in this movie, you see what you have when you have nothing. You have what's left. You have kindness. You have compassion. You have love, possibly, if you go there. It's a choice, you know. I mean, we can do good things. We can do bad things. We can be taught to do good as much as we can be taught to do harm. And that's what it's about. I think that's what they learn, you know. In the beginning, when the wife in the flashbacks is saying, well, why survive? What do you want to do? I don't want to just survive, you know. How are you going to do that? Well, I don't know how. And I don't really know why, I don't think. And I think by the end, learning it on my own, but also learning it from the boy, who is not just a sounding board and a travel companion, but he becomes moral compass in a way. You know, from that moment where he says, I am the one, from then on, it changes, you know, and he grows. I think by the end, I know why. You know, I want to live as long as I can, and why I want him to live. I know what being a good guy means. I know what carrying the fire means. It means something more. When you have nothing, that's what's there, potentially.
I kind of feel like that we're in a time where, in the arts, and particularly in movies lately, there seem to be a lot of men looking for the answer as to what it is to be a man in this era. And I don't know, it was the war or the Bush administration or, you know, decades of comfort for the baby boom or whatever it was that have changed. But it does seem like this question of, okay, I've had all these things, now what does it really mean?
It could be.
Seems to be there.
Well, it's that thing that most people, as they get older, certainly, or people around them get ill, or family members get sick, die, when you yourself, when you get sick, when you start getting frail, you know, it happens to everybody. And then you start to realize it's not about all these other things, it's really about this. And what do I have inside, and why am I? What's the point? I mean, there's plenty of people that we see along the way in this movie who are just staying alive to stay alive without an idea. There's no higher goal to it. It's just finding food, kill people if you have to, eat them even, you know, whatever you gotta do. And I think that I knew that this is what it was about, but the experience of telling the story, especially telling it with Cody, you know, it got really close, and we were really there for each other, which I think you can feel that, you know.
Kind of had to be to...
It wouldn't have worked.
It's a two-person show.
But aside from the fact that it had to be, had to, you know, it just happened anyway, which was great. I think that you realize that there is, no matter how hard the journey is for any individual or for society, that there is a reward. There is something uplifting. There is a joy to be found in electing compassion mm-hmm. and love over fear and contempt, you know, mm-hmm. for other people, for life. It shows. And I do think that it was helpful that it wasn't a bunch of green screen. It wasn't what people might think, you know, post-apocalyptic movie. Okay, it's going to be all that stuff, you know, tidal waves and giant. I mean, there is that. It looks beautiful, the stuff that needs to be there. That's in the world in decay, nature dying and all that. But it was really helpful to us that it was cold, that we were in these environments mm-hmm. because I don't think, without it being exaggerated, the fact that it was so realistically done, so organically mm-hmm. done, technically, the way that landscape was shown, those landscapes, I've never, it really felt emotionally real. Mm-hmm. You know, I've never felt that in a movie that the landscape I was working in mm-hmm. was so much a character. You know, it felt like it was really alive in its you know, its death throes, you know, mm-hmm. that it was you know, it's terrible and it's sad what you're seeing and what you feel from the landscape, but there's something beautiful, you know, those last glimmers of mm-hmm. beauty in the landscape and the absence of so many things,
stuff.
You know?
There's so much stuff now.
Yeah. No, and it really helped. And I know that it helped Cody a lot, you know, because he's a kid who comes from South Australia and he'd never seen snow, you know? So now all of a sudden he's thrown into such a situation where the water is freezing cold, the air, you know?
But John was saying that the just being able to shoot on that road, on that journey, was, you know, big fight. That was the one of the, in terms of getting the production together and the money settled, that they had taken this trip and kind of went through the four states finding these locations mm-hmm. and that was their big, you know, they knew that had to be at the heart of it.
Yeah, no, he went to a great effort, but to his credit and his team, it was a credit to those guys that they didn't let the landscape overwhelm mm-hmm. the human story, because that's what it's about in the end. I mean, it's a backdrop in a way, and I think Cormac McCarthy, who wrote the book mm-hmm. and our movie adaptation of his book, intentionally doesn't explain how it got to be that way, and mm-hmm. it doesn't really matter in a way whether it was some cataclysm, you know, natural thing, or a combination of natural disaster or man-made mm-hmm. disaster, war, whatever. In a sense, it doesn't matter because it's the backdrop. It's mm-hmm. the taking everything away, you know.
It's almost a metaphor.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not really necessarily literal even so much. I mean, that's...
It's a vehicle. What it does is it exposes us. And let's just say the parent's concern, which most people can probably identify with, certainly mm-hmm. any parent who cares at all about their child or children can understand that worry. Well, I'm going to leave my kid alone for an hour, I don't know, or, you know, are they going to be all right, or mm-hmm. I'm not going to see him for a week, or as they get older, I'm not going to see him for a month, maybe, or when they leave the nest, are they going to be okay? You know, you really want to know, it's not so much, are they going to have enough money, because mm-hmm. Money is just a thing, it's a means to being comfortable, to being safe, to being happy, all those things. I think also, if you're a decent parent, you want your kid to be a good guy. You know, mm-hmm. really, you want them to be kind. You want them to be a force for good and not a force for evil or for hatred. You want them to get along with mm-hmm. the other kids, with the other adults when they become adults. And I think it just, by stripping everything away, mm-hmm. it really exaggerates that, because we know if and when, and right. it's only a matter of time, you can see as a man is pretty frail as time goes on, the kid's going to be left not only without enough money or mm-hmm. to go to college or something, he's going to be left with nothing, you know, nothing, mm-hmm. no food, no shelter, no friends, no safety. But somehow my character evolves largely because of this relationship, because what he learns from his own son mm-hmm. he is at peace towards the end of the story because he realizes that his son is indeed one of the good guys, and that his kid understands completely what carrying the fire means, a phrase that's used in the movie a lot. Mm. And in the book, you know, that the kid is has a good heart.
Your character is definitely a good guy, but he's also
makes mistakes,
carrying all these other things. And his son definitely is turning into, I guess, you know, what we call 2.0 of his dad. I mean, he's got the survival skills and all that, but mostly he's learned something that his father, you know, as you say, he had to teach his father.
Well, and that happens too. Parents know that thing. When kids are adolescents, you know, they generally, if the parent's paying attention and there's a relationship that's functional, you know, that there's a that they relate to each other, at some point the kid's going to call the father or the mother on all the things that they're always telling them, advising them they should do, and how they should behave, and how what kind of language they should use, how they should treat others. And in fact, we see this. You know, the kid calls him on. He says, "Well, you always say we should do this and we should do that, and then you do another thing." And, you know, and what can you say? That's that transition that the children have to make.
As the story also has the great element, I mean, particularly in the Duval sequence, of having the experience and then moving on. You know, it's all the fear that is there going into it, and what is this going to be? And then it turns out to be an experience and not really a game changer for them, but with an experience that really helps them both move along.
Yeah, definitely. It was interesting. We did, you know, we've done some screenings where there's Q&As afterwards, and there was a question that I'd never heard in last night. That was the last question of the night. And I thought it was a really good one. She said, "Well, there's all this talk about you got to go south and you got to go to the sea, and then you get there and there's nothing. And you know, what was the point of the south and the sea?" I said, "Well, apart from, as the wife says, you know, you have to go south. You'll never survive another winter here." She says, "The idea is that it's going to be warmer, and it's to some degree, well, to a large degree, it's a dream. It's a hopeful, you know, thing." That there might be people, there might be good people there. There might be some sustenance, something to eat. There might be something, the sea, I don't know. The idea of the sea itself, it seems positive, seems hopeful. And then they get there and it's devastating because it's really not much different than anywhere they've been. And it's not really any warmer either. And
it's a lot like Hollywood.
Yeah. And, well, yeah, sure. It's true. but you know, and I said, well, you know, I think that it's that cliche, and like all cliches, they're often true, that it's about the journey you're on, not the destination. You know, it's something that they've had all along, and they just have to come to realize it if they're going to. They have each other, and they have, for lack of a better word, they have love. You know, and that's what's important. It's what they're carrying with them, not where they're headed to. You know, it'd be great if they found something, but the dad is never going to know whether he finds good people or not. You know, but he feels okay towards the end because he sees that his son has that thing, has that light. You know.
Yeah. So do you, at this point, the last few directors you've worked with have all been admirable in many ways. I mean, I think they all bring something to the table that it's not like you're not making Michael Bay movies, so not ripping to Michael Bay too much, but you know, you're not doing that. I mean, between Cronenberg and John and Ed Harris in the middle, who obviously cares deeply about everything he does, you're choosing to be with directors who seem to be on that path. Is that the thoughtful choice? Is that the road that you're...
Well, the choice is part of it, yes. I mean, there were other things I could have done. But that, you know, people have this idea that if you started working and you have a career that's moving along, that you're making a living as an actor, that you have a lot more say in matters, you know, as far as what you're going to get to do as an actor, than you really do. I mean, I can only say yes if they want me to do it.
Right.
Or if I can talk them into it or something. So I have to say I've been lucky as well to work with all these people and work with these stories and these characters. But yeah, I mean, I've always tried to find stories that would be challenging. In this case, as we talked about, I knew it was a good story, but I didn't know if I was gonna, you don't know until you get there, if I would be up to the task. You know, in the same sense that how to be a parent and how to be a child, you know, it's something you learn on the job.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going to find out till you're doing it, and you're probably going to know a lot more than you think if you just trust it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like any relationship.
So is the first building block of your relationships with these films the director, or is it script, is it the character?
It's the story and it's the character. If I like the story, and assuming they're interested in me being mm-hmm. part of it, for me there needs to be an element of fear. I have to feel mm-hmm. like it could very possibly not work.
Mm-hmm.
But if it works, it could be a very good story.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and in this case, the weather was helped us. The boy was a brilliant actor. We had a great, you know, the whole cast. I mean, every once in a while, you know, we'd be alone doing mm-hmm. our work every day, and then every once in a while, someone like Robert Duvall would show up, or Guy Pearce, or Charlize Theron, mm-hmm. obviously. And there were a lot of things that were planned well, but we also got lucky.
Mm-hmm.
You know, things just gelled in a way, and things went further. There was more to it than mm-hmm. I thought there would be, and there was less to it in a good mm-hmm. way. It was leaner, simpler, more real. The big challenge of it, for the boy especially, mm-hmm. and for my character, for both of us, starting out, was knowing that if it's going to work, there's no place to hide emotionally. It has to be very real.
Mm-hmm.
You have to really believe that they're going through this and that they feel these things for each other and about the world they're in, or it's not going to work. You know, there's no special effect. There's no cutting around it. It's going to have to work on an emotional level.
When you have to tell us a lot without having dialogue even.
Yeah.
Because a lot of your emotional conversions from inside of scenes
mm-hmm.
are completely in your eyes. We don't get, you know, with that beard, we don't even get your jawline.
That's true.
To help us out. So it's really almost a silent performance by you, and a lot of, you know, for a lot of the movie.
But that's a good challenge. Yeah, in most movies, I gotta say the scripts aren't that good, so mm-hmm. it's better to not have words. But in this case, the script was good, so when we did get to speak, it was helpful.
So is that extra challenging to do a performance like that, where so much is just the camera on you, thinking, considering?
No, I like it. You have to be lucky to have an editor or director or both
mm-hmm.
pay attention to those details, you know, as they're shooting and as they're cutting the movie. A lot of times, you know, that's why Cronenberg was so great, because mm-hmm. he loved the subtle reactions, and he trusted that it would work on screen when mm-hmm. it didn't look like much was going on, but he's watching, you know, he has a really keen eye.
Mm-hmm.
You need directors who pay attention to the little things that the boy does, the little things that I do, because that's the story. But largely the story is in their faces, you mm-hmm. know, as much as the landscape's vital, it's really there. And I like doing that kind of work. I mean, Ed Harris also allowed mm-hmm. for that. The character I played for him and with him had a lot going on,
yeah,
you know, between the words, and I like that challenge. But and it's always tricky. You never know if it's going to quite work or mm-hmm. not. It's a fine thing, just as the emotion, you know, it could, on an emotional level, this could have been really over the top and like, mm-hmm. okay, enough already with the, you know, the crying and the the suffering and the, you know, as much as it's uplifting at the end, really, and yeah. hopeful, there's a journey that's going to be tough and you got to go there.
He walks that line so carefully. You know, there's so many opportunities for gore, for things, and there are horrible images at moments, but
there's more suggested than shown.
Yes, much more so.
Yeah, he did that in a classy way, I thought. Because another director would have made it a horror movie.
Well, it's not really the, you know, it's so not, in some ways it's not the point, and in some ways I think the way you have the experience and the, so much of the experience is you two watching what's going on or not watching what's going on.
I mean, trying to keep them from seeing what's
yeah.
going on, yeah.
So, I mean, but you also, we have pity for the people who are doing these terrible things.
Yeah.
I think is part of the process.
There's a desperation there, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, I gotta say, when people say, well, do you think the world could get that bad? And I said, well, I don't know where you've been, but for a lot of people in this country and many more around the world, we're there. You know,
yeah.
they are living in desperation. And that's always been true
yeah.
for human beings, but it's really, there are noticeably large numbers of people living at the very edge, yeah. You know, and it's not just the obvious, you know, people that look like us that have shopping carts, right. And are living on the street. It's, you know, a lot more and more people,
yeah.
are living that way. And as far as landscape, you know, you got to just take a plane ride and look out the window. In this country or any other, there's a lot of environmental damage.
Yeah.
There are a lot of changes, and in a lot of places, and in a lot of people's lives, we're there. I mean, it's not so far-fetched. I'm not saying it's going to completely be that way, but...
Well, the level of inhumanity, you know, is something in America we just don't face. I mean, we have so many buffers to keep us, you know, so many McDonald's and so many television shows and so many just things.
But there's also, it's not just that, and I agree, it's like the distraction. I want this, I want my stuff, and I don't want you to have your stuff. And that can be when you have nothing, the way I act sometimes. Ideally to protect the boy, but not wanting to give people any of our stuff. Mm-hmm. But it's also the idea of not taking revenge, of not being vengeful, of not being hateful, you know. There's a quote that I mentioned a couple times because it was something that I had. It was one of the things I had written down that I would look at, and I had in my script and stuff, and I have in the book. By Eleanor Roosevelt, which I thought was had a lot to do with this story, and she said, "When will our consciences grow so tender that we act to prevent misery rather than avenge it?" You know, and that's one of the central concerns of the story, and it's in fact what the boy teaches, in part teaches me, reminds me. I thought you said we were going to be nice to people, essentially, you know, and not be so fearful and run from them, you know. I mean, he's not saying that, but he is, basically.
Well, and I think he's expressing that he wants to, that's how he feels he should live.
Yeah.
He's learned how to, what makes him feel like a human being.
And it is the example I've generally tried to give, but I've broken my own rules, you know.
Well, fear is a funny thing.
Yeah.
I mean, it's
desperation,
the ultimate.
Yeah.
So does, when you do the sequence, like the Duvall sequence, is it just fun to have a, you know, a legend walk on the set and act?
Totally.
I mean, it's so rare that we get to see him really, you know, in his own movies that he's involved with, he does great stuff, and then he'll do a commercial movie or whatever and just kind of throw it away. But to see him in 3 or 4 minutes of screen time give a performance,
it's
so powerful here.
Yeah, he nailed it. He nailed it. And it was, by the way, great to see Cody be... not unimpressed. He hadn't seen his movies really. Mm-hmm. You know, that was fun. I mean, getting DVDs. Mm-hmm. And so, you should watch this. You should watch this. And, you know, and then when he started, he tended to go more toward Mel Brooks than wanting to see The Godfather and stuff. But you know, I got him to see a certain amount of movies that I thought he should see. I said, "You're doing things that, you know, just out of your own training or from your life experience, instinctively."
Mm-hmm.
That these great actors, including Robert Duvall, you know, pioneered to some degree, and Marlon Brando's, and then he'd say, "Who's Marlon Brando?" You know, like that.
Mm.
But with Duvall, you know, he could see, smart kid, he could see, wow, he goes, he's a cool old guy, and I'm like, yeah, he is. but it went the other way too.
Yeah.
Duvall, after like a few minutes, he goes, "Where'd they get the kid?" You know, wow,
it's impressive.
Yeah.
Well, isn't that the ultimate thing? Is for us to, I mean, obviously you're performing as a character, but the soul that we're seeing is Viggo's soul. No,
and this character probably more than. Than most, maybe more than any other one I've played, it was that all the time. I mean, it always is to some degree. It's always got to be there, I think, or it's not. I mean, that's what you're working with, your own, what you are, what you have, what you've lived, what you feel. But in this case, then that was the thing that was scary, which I knew was the reason to do it, really, was more than any other reason, was that I was going to have to be there that way. I was going to have to show that in some way, little ways and big ways, all the time.
It's rare these days. And I do think I think that some of the negative reviews of the movie, and there's always some, but, you know, I think it's part of the response is almost intimidated by the intimacy of it and the fact that it connects in such a personal way. I think it's, you know, throws critics off when they have to feel instead of think.
Well, who knows? Maybe they're working out issues of their own emotionally. I don't know. I'm not going to fault anyone. I can't. Right. I never expect it's impossible. Everybody's going to like what you do. But I know that I felt that we got a lot done and we've got to places together. And I mean, I can only have done so much of that on my own. I needed a boy who could go there and inspire me, you know, and hopefully I could inspire him as well. And I had that. So I know that together we went places that we didn't know what those places would be. We hoped we would get to places like that. And we got there. And, you know, they can't take that away from us.
So when you saw the movie, were you surprised by much of it? Or were you so conscious of everything you had done that it made
there's
it
always
all
that.
Together?
There's always the thing where you, you know, oh, why didn't they show a little more of that or less of that or something?
Right.
But in general, I felt overall like we had captured the spirit of the book and we had captured those things that we've been speaking about, you know, that what, in the end, what's the basis of kindness or of being human, you know, and how do you show that? You have to feel it when you see it. And I thought that we'd, I felt that from the movie, you know, I felt strangely uplifted, you know. I felt sad, but calm. I felt an urge to make even more of an effort to make contact with all my family members and friends, you know. And I've had a lot of people react that way, say, I had to call my mom, I had to call my kid, you know, after I saw the movie. It was, you know, some people have been very upset, you know. So, but I've seen a lot of people walk out with, like, it had been obvious that they'd been crying, or but that they were smiling, too, at the same time, you know.
Yeah.
And that, visually, is the is the effect it had on me, and the effect I would hope it would have on some other people.
You know, tragic hopefulness is an interesting. It's all, when those, when there are very few movies that you get to the end, and you know, it could be described as an unhappy journey on some level, but it's really hopeful.
Well,
you know,
it's rewarding because it's honest.
Yeah.
You know.
But it is a hopeful movie. It is in the end.
Totally.
About the spirit of moving on and giving to the next generation, to all those things.
Yeah.
And do you judge yourself when you watch the movie?
Oh, yeah.
So is that, have you gotten used to that, or is it hard still? Or?
No, I got used to that a long time ago. I know there's actors who cannot watch themselves because it sends them into a, you know, tailspin of just horrible self-loathing and regret. And, you know, I can always see things that I can improve on, and I look at that as, well, next time around maybe I'll be more aware of that aspect or something, but you know, you do your best, and then you look at it, and maybe you can learn something from it. And if you're really lucky, because any movie, doesn't matter if the script is great or not, if the cast is really good in principle or not, the director has a great track record or not, in the end, it's always going to be about the compromise that a group of people make. And there's an unknown there. There's something mysterious, just like the emotional states and just physically how we look. It's beyond makeup. It's beyond what we thought the scene would be sometimes. It's about a leap of faith that's made not just by the actors on screen, but everybody there. Somehow, you know, there's something like a spiritual thing to making movies. It replaces, for some people, or if not replaces, is for some people what temple, church, the mosque, theater and its origins was, you know, an experience where you're setting, you know, you have the words, you have the vestments, you have the setting, you have the lights, you have the circumstances are correct, are ready, everybody's rehearsed, everybody's prepared for this ritual, and now we say action, and then we're hoping something happens that's beyond explanation. There are things that you see in a close-up in a movie sometimes, or the composition of a wide shot, and you go, I really feel that. I can't really put my finger on it, but it really, really works, you know. And if in a movie you have a couple of moments like that, that's great. And I think this movie, in general, has that running through it, and it comes to the surface several times, and it ends in that way for me.
Yeah.
You know.
Oh, all those little pieces coming together into something that emotional and that human and real and connected is. It's an amazing thing that it gets done ever.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's a tricky thing, and some movies are more tricky than others. But I can say that, for example, there were scenes where, without ruining for anybody, with the Cody, where the boy has to, he had to go to some places and really get there, and it was incredibly moving to be in the scene and feel that coming off him and going back and forth. And the crew members who were watching on the video assist, you know, some of them just turned away. They couldn't even watch it. Mm-hmm. You know, most of them. And there was this silence after some scenes that was not so much about respecting the actors, but respecting the moment, mm-hmm. or the moments that everybody felt. And then you hope it gets put together right, which I think, for the most part, they did.
I think so too. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot for your time.
Appreciate your time.
I know we went way over, didn't we?
That's okay.